Hey, this is the Daily Overpass. My name is Eric and I make apps. Now today I'm going to talk about why we are moving away from the Ionic Framework. Okay, so the other day I had two questions come in on two separate videos which I responded to, and the answer was very similar, right? And I nearly didn't answer them because they were questions that I think I've touched on before in past videos, but then as I was thinking about it, things had changed a little bit, especially my feelings around hybrid frameworks and the Ionic framework in particular. So the first one came in on episode 270 from Mr. Neptune, said, "Hey Eric, what do you use to code your apps?" I was gonna be very flippant and say a computer, but I thought, you know, dad joke. So I didn't go with that one. And then also on episode 266, Media360 said, "I want to make Android apps. What's the best platform for beginners?" So I said this in the beginning. If you wanna be completely safe, go native, you know, but native takes a long time. You'd code two separate app bases, but you don't have to worry going forward, right? In the past, you know, I talk about different things. If you're doing games, we'd always do Corona. We do Corona SDK. I'm a big fan of that framework, but it seems like a lot of the excitement about that platform has gone off. Like even books, there hasn't been any books written lately on it that I've seen, right? Everything, all the big major publications of it were back in like 2013, 2014, right? It just seems like it's kind of fading away. That might be completely wrong, and you might not find that. You might be a Corona developer and say, "No, it's actually a vibrant community," but not in my opinion. To me, it just seems to be kind of fading away a little bit. So I'm starting to look more towards Unity there. On the app side, on the business app side, I am a big fan of the Ionic framework. I've talked about this many times before. A lot of our client stuff is done on Ionic. I like using JavaScript. I like using the Cordova plugins and everything like that. And a lot of things we've done in Ionic. A lot of the client stuff, right? We use Ionic 1 and then Ionic 2. And it's just, the platform keeps getting better and better and better. I'm a huge fan. However, a few months ago, if you watch the channel, you know, we talked a lot about the changes in the Apple guidelines. First of all, there was Apple 4.3 about spamming the store, which was there for ages, but they really started to crack down on it. You know, especially, it's mainly punishing developers with lots of apps. And I think it's just lazy reviewers who don't want to review stuff. So they're starting to push back on that. And then there was the guideline 4.2.6. I think it was 4.2.6 or 4.2.9, I forget which one it is, but it's the one that says anything that's wizard generated will get rejected, right? And there was a huge outcry on that. There was a change.org petition, and Apple has softened their language on that since then because it affected a lot of people. People using Good Barber and Appy Pie and business apps and all this kind of stuff, right? And I was actually free and clear of that. I didn't have anything like that, although we were working on a similar product ages ago, like a WYSIWYG kind of build your app type of thing, until I realized we didn't have too much client work coming in, didn't have the time or the resources to keep up with it, so we just sort of let it fall by the wayside. But the scary thing about that was that Apple started rejecting apps, not because of the quality of the app, but because of how they were made, right? And that was one of the reasons there was a big outcry. Now, it didn't affect me at all, but it did make me think about a lot of things. Mainly that Apple has no problems with ignoring a huge amount of their users and their developers and just pushing them aside, no matter how many people are using that framework, and just say, "Sorry, we're not gonna support it anymore," right? I just thought it was crazy. But if you ever follow Apple, you know they did the same thing with Flash developers. When all the Flash developers back when the iPhone, iPad came out saying, "When are you gonna support Flash?" And they said, "We ain't never gonna support Flash," right? It doesn't matter how often it's used on the web, you're just gonna have to move to something else. And then Flash developers, they went through a very hard time, and I don't know if any exists still, but you know, it's just, you know, Apple has some balls. Sorry to be, if it's rude, I don't know if that's rude to you, but you know, they will completely push aside a group of people. Now, back to Ionic. Ionic is fine. Cordova is fine. All of those phone gap type things, they're all fine. But it made me think, what if at some point they reject that? You know, even this morning I was reading an article, I think it was Philip Krause, the guy who does Fastlane, he put it up about how much a security liability using web views and apps are, because it bypasses a lot of different things. And there was, you know, some people are saying we shouldn't be, you know, Cordova apps and Ionic apps shouldn't even be allowed. I mean, it's a very small group of people, but it started to make me think, what if Apple just does an about face on that? So the whole thing, so for those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, Ionic and Cordova, they're web-based frameworks. So they can have all the functionality of a regular app because they have plugins, but it still sits inside a little web browser within the application that you have total control of. It doesn't necessarily need a download from the web, but it runs locally, and so you have CSS and HTML, and it looks just like a native application. Some people complain that it's a little bit more laggy. They're always improving on that, and you can code it in a certain way that you get rid of the lag, but it's just there. But it's still running in a web view, right? And that's kind of what kind of defines it. You're seeing a lot of other frameworks that are coming out lately that are not necessarily native components, but they are compiling into native code. I mentioned it before, the last few projects. So this, after that 4.2.6 thing, to let you know where I'm going with this, and you might disagree with this, we started to move towards React Native for new projects. Now, we still use Ionic for the legacy stuff. You know, I'm not going to rewrite anything. You know, I'm not going to rewrite anything unless we absolutely have to. So if somebody comes back with like a little enhancement, we're still keeping Ionic going, still keeping those skills and everything, but we're starting to move more towards React Native. Although, I've mentioned before, my problem with React Native is that Facebook is in charge of it, and Facebook pulled the rug out from underneath me on Parse, right? And that's just one of those things I kind of think. There's also the native script, which is done by Telerik, I think, which does actually interfaces with native components and everything like that. But you know, I don't see a huge community there. And then just this weekend, I started looking at Flutter.io, which is done by Google, and that looks like it might have a bit of things. So there's a lot of things moving it, but Flutter.io uses Dart as a language, and I don't know anybody who's a Dart developer. And I'm thinking, should we learn Dart? You know, is it worth investing in that? But you know, so if you're just getting started in software and you learn Dart and that thing really takes off, you'll be set. You can just charge whatever you want. So anyway, so this is one of the reasons. I am not against the Ionic framework. I love the Ionic framework. I've been to Ionic framework meetups in London. You know, I'm following everything they do. I watch their their videos and everything like that. But my fear from a business point of view is that Apple calls the shots, right? And you have to anticipate, you know, what happens if Apple pulls the rug out from underneath us the way they did with wizard generated things a few months ago, and then we'd all be screwed. So anyway, that's just my thinking on the topic. Let me know what you guys think. By the way, if you're just starting out and you want to do something that's safe or something safe for your clients, you could go native, but you're talking about having two different code bases, you know, Swift or Objective-C on this side, Java, Android on this side, right? So you have higher costs, you have higher everything else, and it's better to have that. I prefer to use a cross platform framework, not necessarily a hybrid one, but cross platform, because we can give like a flat low price to our clients, right? And for both platforms, and we stays competitive that way. So, and more fun to work with, in my opinion. So, anyway, let me know what you guys think, right? Do you completely disagree with me on that? Is Ionic? Am I being harsh with Ionic? Hey, if personal web apps take off, that's going to be game changer. Everything's going to change there. But so anyway, let me know what you guys think. That's it for today. I'll talk to you guys tomorrow. Bye.